order. I'd like to welcome everybody. Teresa, we have confirmation of quorum, correct?
Yes, we do.
Okay, so welcome. We have confirmation of quorum. We need someone to approve the meeting minutes from the last meeting of the curriculum committee, if you would.
So moved.
Second.
I guess we just go to the first. Go ahead.
Before we start the meeting, the members of the committee, could you just raise your hand exactly who was on the curriculum committee? Those are the people who get to speak tonight. Unfortunately, the public does not get to speak tonight. You can take notes, you can do whatever you need to do, but this is a meeting of the curriculum committee to hear what we have to hear tonight. Okay?
Okay, so we have items for review.
Point of order.
Certainly.
Maria, can you call for a vote on the approval of minutes, please?
Can we have an approval on the minutes from the last curriculum?
All those in favor?
All those in favor say aye, please.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay, so the minutes passed. We'll go to items for review and action. Proposed non-leveling of classes, middle school level.
Maria?
Yes.
Do you have to have a motion to take it off the table?
It was tabled, so you need a motion to take it off.
Sorry, folks, bear with me. I'm relatively new. I'm very new at this. Okay, so we need.
I move to take the item proposal non-leveling of classes off the table. We have back on the agenda.
Second?
Madam Chair, point of order. The person who takes it, offers to take it off the table, has to be someone who voted to table it.
Sorry, I was absent.
I move to take it off the table and put it on the agenda.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so the motion carries.
Okay, so Brian Darcy, who's the principal at Worcester, and Leanne Brent, who's the principal at Flood, have done a lot of research and would like to present you their proposal.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Good evening. Dr. Robinson did a nice job introducing us, but again, I will introduce myself, Leanne Bradford, principal of Flood Middle School.
And Brian Darcy, principal over at Worcester Middle School.
Before we get started, we just want to thank you all for coming out tonight. We know your schedules are busy, and the fact that you're here committed to our district and what we're trying to do really shows a collaborative effort. So we do thank you for coming out tonight. We are here this evening to present a proposal to you, a proposal that really focuses on an improvement strategy. And our goal as educators is always to focus on how we improve our schools. So tonight we are proposing non-leveling at the middle school level. Before we go into our presentation, we want to apologize because on our presentation, on the title page, many of you may have noticed that the title reads non-levels in the middle schools. And so the assumption may have been that we were eliminating honors. And so we want to apologize because that's not the case. The title is non-levels in the middle schools with an honors option. So please note that we will be proposing non-leveling, but we still will have the honors option. So I know that there was some miscommunication about that. So before we got into it, I really wanted to clear up that miscommunication. So some people are really stuck on that title, non-leveling, and what does that mean, and why are we non-leveling? So if you don't like that title or that's not sitting well with you, another way that you can think of it is, how do we accelerate learning for all students, okay? So again, just to give you a different angle, a different lens to look through, it's the same concept. How do we accelerate learning for all students? That's our proposal this evening. Last but not least, as we go through the presentation, as a group, because we're all partners, we're all around the table, we all want the same thing, we ask you to try to remove any bias or barriers that you may have surrounding this topic. Come in with an open mindset, a growth mindset, listen attentively to our presentation, and if you have questions or concerns, If you can save those until the end of the presentation, we would appreciate it. So the first thing we'd like to present to you is our theory of action. Or another way that you can phrase this is a theory of change. And in the education world, as educators, we are constantly thinking about a theory of action. What can we do to improve our schools? So we framed our presentation as a theory of action. And we believe if we increase advanced opportunities for all students, then we increase academic achievement and social awareness for all students. That's our theory of action. That's what we believe strongly as educators. If we do this, this will be our outcome. So we work around theories of action on a daily basis. Without even thinking about it, we make these assumptions. If we do this, then this would happen. If we do this, then that would happen. This is a more formalized way to present the theory of action embedded in an improvement strategy tonight. And then the next thing we want to reference is a powerful quote. Tracking and ability grouping in many communities serve as a major vehicle to institutionalize and perpetuate racial division on campus. And we start with this quote because it's powerful and it's the truth. And we are here as transparent with you as possible, talking about the option of non-leveling with honors. And when you talk about that, you cannot avoid the quote before you. I will end with, we often hear our Board of Education and our leadership team talk about the North and the South Stratford, and how we don't want a North End and a South End of Stratford. How we want one Stratford, one school district. So our proposal tonight with the non-leveling with the honors option is our effort to create and unite us as one Stratford. So we have our presentation framed using the PELP coherent framework. Dr. Richard Elmore, he is known as the guru of education reform, the father of reform. All of his work is really grounded in research. He's a professor at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. So a lot of our work and our decision making, we really reference and frame all of our decisions based on the instructional core. So if you look at this framework, tonight we are talking about the instructional core and what is in the best interest of students. If you see that center circle is about students. This is not about us or what's best for us or what's best for the teachers. This is about what is best for students. So that's the instructional core that we're talking about. The strategy to improve student achievement is really the non-leveling with the honors option. Now, there are elements surrounding the strategy. Those elements could either help us or hinder us as we work on the improvement strategy. So all of those surrounding elements, culture, structure, system, stakeholders, which would be all of you, resources, the environment, regulations, all of those things can help this improvement strategy or hinder it. So we are here tonight hoping that you will help us with the improvement strategy.
Next thing that we want to get to was how we arrived here this evening. So some historical context over the last few years, and including discussions that Leanne and I have had since we've been building principles over the last 2 years, almost 2 years. First thing that I would say is that non-leveling, or this idea, has been discussed for the last few years in Stratford at both the building level and the administrative level, as far as with teachers, with some parents at the administrative level here at central office, in meetings, that countless meetings that we've been in, and talked about the pros and cons throughout the entire process. What has been in place for a number of years here in Stratford? Why do we need to make a change? How will we be able to measure this change down the road as well? Also, a few things of notation. At the elementary schools, technically right now, there is no leveling, there is no tracking. They do collect data, but the students are grouped together. So 7th and 8th grade right now are the only 2 years in Stratford, other than when you get to the higher levels in high school, where students are tracked accordingly into two different levels, as far as a levels one and an honors program. When you get into the high school, once again, when you get into 9th grade, that's again now non-leveled as far as 9th grade, English language arts, and then the civics classes as well. We also know that the community of Stratford, and that's parents, all stakeholders, teachers, administrators, etc., are involved in currently the design of a 5-year plan. And we'll touch upon how that gets into the vision later on throughout the presentation and towards the end of it when we conclude. But I will say also that being part of that process myself, there are a number of initiatives that are coming down very soon through the work that we're doing over the next few years. That includes possible schedule changes at both the high schools and the middle schools as a possibility. That's talking about mastery-based learning. And that's going to be something that comes up on the horizon. It's been spoken. We've been discussing it for the last couple years as well. A number of us in the district have been going to professional development sessions outside of the district to learn about mastery-based learning, to see how it would fit into Stratford, etc. We have seen and done research on our current achievement gap and how we can improve upon that based on not only what the research but also what the state is telling us, some initiatives that we should try as well. And both schools, as far as differentiation and questioning, both schools have specifically concentrated on these two areas for the last 2 years as far as teacher training, whether it's during faculty meetings, staff meetings, or any other professional development sessions that have occurred, and that comes from outside training as well. As far as start of our research, obviously we're getting into some achievement gap areas as well, and when we get to socioeconomic and when it's related to race. The first one up there, as you can see, is about African American and Hispanic students are currently, and this is nationally based research, are in overpopulated in areas of lower levels and obviously underrepresented or underpopulated in the higher tracts. So that's what causes that social segregation, if you will, of socioeconomic status, race, etc., when you look at some of the national research. Students in lower socioeconomic, so if you don't want to relate it just to race, only have a 50% chance of being placed into a higher track, meaning that honors level class, which obviously has increased the socioeconomic situation there. And the most powerful part of the research was that the research has shown that it's really hard, and some studies have shown that they will never get out of those lower tracks. So if we start tracking and grouping students by ability in lower levels, it's setting them up for failure. They're never going to have the opportunities to go to middle school and high school to be able to get into the higher tracks. So you're already setting them up. They're already labeled as students who can't achieve, regardless of race, ethnicity, and socioeconomic status.
Okay, Mr. Darcy talked a little bit or referenced a little bit about the achievement gap. Here is a quote that I'd like to actually read to you. "Addressing the achievement disparities in Connecticut is more than just our moral obligation. It makes fiscal sense. In Connecticut, the cost of remediation or incarceration are greater than education. In order to address the conditions that perpetuate underachievement, we must confront poverty and systemic barriers while constantly improving our practice in all state agencies." That is what we're doing as we present this proposal to you. We're really trying to address the conditions of underachievement and really accelerate learning for all students. Continuing with the quote, "We must also develop a collaborative engagement within public and private agencies and our public education system. This collaboration must propel our collective goal," our collective goal meaning all of us collectively, "of addressing the gaps." And this quote is from Dr. Miguel Cardona. He's actually the co-chairperson of the Connecticut Legislative Achievement Gap Task Force. So the state recognizes that this is a huge concern, that they have really created this task force to try to close our achievement gaps by the year 2020. So another quote from the research that we looked at regarding the task force They say low-income students in particular need exposure in school to a rich array of topics, skills, and knowledge because they are less likely than their more affluent peers to receive this exposure at home or through extracurricular activities. So what does that mean? It means equity for all, equality for all. The same thing we started with tonight. It means accelerating learning for all students. That is what that quote means. So you've probably heard Dr. Robinson talk about student number 31 for ALPS. And what are we doing to accelerate learning for number 31? And that's powerful, because there's always a 31. But I'll take it a step further, and I will say, what about number 40? Or what about number 45? What about number 61? Don't they all matter? Of course they do. And so this proposal will help us address all of those other numbers that didn't make the cut. It's not about the 30. It's about all students. And we have to really realize that at the core level, internally, it's not about the 30. And so this proposal will help us eliminate that barrier. This is really our collaborative engagement to move the improvement strategy forward. And I'm really proud of our district because we're having this courageous conversation. This is a controversial topic. And the fact that we're here tonight talking about what is in the best interest of our students, we have to give ourselves credit for. The last thing I want to say when I refer to the task force.
I want to get to the data.
I know, but this is important. You'll like this, Mr. Darcy. You'll like this.
The data.
When I did the research on the task force, I was also very honored because we have one of our curriculum committee members who is actually part of the task force, and that's Mr. David Kennedy. As we read through this research, I always like to look at the end, like who actually wrote this. And if we can give a round of applause, because Mr. David Kennedy is part of
the I want to share this with the task force if I can.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And I do have a copy, so after, if you're interested in more of that research, I do have one copy here to look at. All yours, Mr. Darcy.
My clicker wasn't working there, okay. Didn't want me to get there. So as far as just looking at some data, when we start talking about achievement gap, those are gonna be the next three slides, and then we'll get to high achieving learners as well, obviously, because we're trying to look at all students as they grow together. So if we just take a look at the Next Generation Accountability Report, these are the new standards and new reports that came out from the Connecticut State Department of Education. So you can see about a 14-50% gap between non-high needs, and just so everyone's aware, the high need groups have to meet one of the criteria: free and reduced lunch, an English language learner, or a student who has disabilities. So that's how the state looks at high needs students. So if you don't meet that criteria, you're in the non-high needs. So if we just look at those areas, when we talk about that achievement gap as it relates to the non-high needs, as I said, you can see a little bit of a gap between all of our indexes, index scores for Stratford as a whole on each level, whether it's our English language, ELA students, our performance in math, and our performance on science. And these are aggregated scores from the SBAC results throughout the district and obviously CMT science. When we get to break it down a little bit more, when we look at specifically just our CMT results, we have the percentages obviously up here, and these are a little bit more discouraging as you start to dive into some of the subgroups, if you will. So as we can see, at or above grade level, as far as above goal, for science CMT, if you take a look at the left-hand column, when you look at white students compared to black and Hispanic, obviously there's a large discrepancy there. So that shows the achievement gap that we're dealing with. And that's why part of the reason why we're here tonight and why this is such a hot button issue for the two of us working so closely together with the middle schools is that we see this as a real threat to Stratford Public Schools that we need to fix. If you take a look at, obviously, at or above proficiency, you can see the results up here as well. And then you look at the socioeconomic piece of this as far as free and reduced lunch compared to full price, looking at about another 16% discrepancy there. Then we dive into our SBAC data, which These are how our subgroup scored on last year's SBAC results. This is specifically just for the middle schools. This is Flood and Worcester Middle School's results combined. We get white students, ELA, at or above 356%, and then as you go down, we have 39 and then 33. And it's an even worse trend if you are a larger gap if you look at the math results, a 32, a 14, and then all the way down to a 10 for our African-American students. So it shows that looking at the data in the district and in the state overall, if you do the research on the state, very comparable to state level as well as far as the achievement gap is concerned.
Can you just stay at that slide for 1 second? I just want to add on to what Mr. Darcy was saying. Recently, one of our teachers came up to us and said, very honestly, why are we doing this? If it's not broke, then why are we trying to fix it? And so Mr. Darcy and I looked at the teacher and said, it is broken. And when you look at this data, the first thing you have to say to yourself, I'm uncomfortable with this. There has to be a sense of urgency to address this. This is broken. And we, as a district, can do better than this. And so I think sometimes when you're unaware of the problem, you can't make informed decisions about how to fix it. So first, I would like to encourage you to be aware, to have a social awareness that this is not what we represent as a district. And we have to be empowered to do something about it. And that's why we're here tonight.
Yeah, and as Ms. Bradford said, if we look at it this way, this is who we are right now. Are we comfortable with this? And through those discussions and having those honest discussions with ourselves, with teachers, with some parents throughout the last few weeks, we're not. That's why we're here this evening as well.
So this slide is very interesting because the research on this slide comes actually from Stratford Public Schools, from our two high schools. So the research that we did, talking to Vanell and Stratford High, 90% of student referrals come from non-honors classes. And when we talk about student referrals, we're talking about behavioral problems that are written up and then sent to the administrators to deal with. So 90% of those behavioral referrals are coming from the non-honors classes. And again, that research is not from a different state, not a different district. That is from our two high schools. Also from our student high schools and what they've seen, students model up their behaviors to peers. When they're in the classroom with the honors option, students are modeling up. When expectations are inconsistent, student behavior is inconsistent. And there are times when the expectations in the non-honors classrooms are different. And so we need to level those expectations and raise the bar so that all students have the same expectations. When students are grouped by ability, the lower level classrooms display more challenging behavior. And again, those are kind of the honest conversations that we had with Dr. Dowling, who's here, thank you for being here, and Mr. Delapiano, who couldn't be here, regarding the honors option at the high school level.
Now the next couple of slides talk about, obviously we understand the other end of the spectrum. How do we continue to challenge those high achieving students? So how do we make sure that students have worked so hard, who have been identified as honor students, that we continue to accelerate them? And now if you look at some of the research that is out there that we've showed on here from Hanover, is that if you just look at basic percentages, what the research will tell you, 60% of the students will reach higher levels just by being in traditional type of classes that are untracked. Just by putting them in there with everyone else, they will still reach that because of their innate abilities, because of their drive and determination to receive that educational standard. The other 30%, so combined 90%, will reach that by looking at special projects, by looking at competition, challenging tasks. And the whole point of this slide is to really show also that as long as we're differentiating, as long as we're giving experiences and being able to give experiences to all students, everyone will rise. So the higher achieving students, in my view, could be held back with leveling as well, because they're not being challenged. If you have a student who's in seventh or eighth grade and they are ready to move forward, but in their curriculum right now, this is where they are, they don't have that ability. It's up to teachers, it's up to us as educators to move them forward. You should be able to tell them, okay, well, maybe try to give us this information this way, or try this type of special project or research and everything else. And that's what should be occurring. And some teachers are doing that right now. Are we doing it across the board? Absolutely not. But we are moving in that direction. So these are some of the ways, based on research and obviously discussions with some of our teachers as well, on how we would reach this. So to reach all students, it's talking about obviously rigor and having clear expectations. And we'll have some authentic type of explanations for you as well. But very first, it's talking about classroom management, obviously. Teachers have to have very clear expectations, whether it's academically and socially as well. So behavior is key. Now, this is what I was sort of talking about before as far as this quotation. Raise the ceiling of expectations continuously so advanced learners are competing against their own abilities instead of the norm. So it's individualized instruction for higher level learners as well. They should be moving past it, not just reaching a norm or reaching a plateau. They should be going through that plateau and going to higher levels. And here are some of the ways that teachers and educators overall would be empowered to do this. You increase that expectation, so students understand and meet the expectations. So when you raise expectations, students meet them, whether it's talking about behavior as far as classroom management or your academic as well, and we'll have other examples of that to show you soon. Provide support. Teachers provide individual support into their lessons. Some of you were at the last presentation that I was in a few weeks ago about scientifically research-based interventions. So SRBI, the handbook, if you will, that now has been approved by the Board of Ed, will show some of that scaffolding of support for different learners throughout that need support in these higher level classes. Demonstrate learning in a variety of ways. That's how people break through. If you have a project, people should be able to articulate the project to best fit their individual needs, so giving student choice. And now, flexible grouping in their classes as well. Heterogeneous and homogeneous grouping is done right now in the classrooms themselves. So depending upon the task or the project, that's being done in our classrooms already. So that's what teachers are doing, some of these things already through differentiation. And you will see some of the, I think people are a little bit worried about different levels and abilities. Right now at the high school and middle school level, students can opt into honors level classes. So that means you already don't have students at the same level, if you will. You could have students that are reading at a lower level than each other, and it's up to the teacher to differentiate for those students to meet all of their individual needs.
Okay, so some of you may be sitting here and you may be thinking, well, why would we do this? Is this the norm? Is this typical for districts? What are the other districts do? So we did a little survey, a little research, and we interviewed 19 districts asking them what their current status is regarding leveling. So of the 19 districts that we reached out to, 17 towns responded. Three have leveling for all four content areas. And the districts that we reached out to are either part of our DIRG or part of our neighboring districts, if you're curious about those districts. So three of those districts have leveling for all four content areas. What we have right now, three. 11 of those districts level for math only, okay? So based on where you are with math, you continue your track based on math. One of the districts will be moving to non-leveling next year, other than math. That's exactly what we're proposing. The same proposal that this district is looking for next year. One district levels for math, and then just by a scheduling default, because they couldn't figure the schedule out, they level for the four contents.
And if I could jump in, that's disheartening. I saw some people make some faces and cringe there. Okay. The answer from that district was they level because it's easier to schedule. It wasn't based on student needs at all.
So think about the PELP framework, right? And what Richard Elmore talks about, right? Your decisions should not be made on scheduling. Your decisions have to be made for the instructional core and what is best for students. And so think back to that framework as we're walking through this presentation. It's not about what is best for the teachers and the schedule. It's what's best for students. So translation, what does all of this mean? It means out of the three current districts who level in all four content areas, only one will be leveling next year. There would be two out of 18 districts, including Stratford, if we don't push this forward, that level for all four content areas next year. So when I look at that, that makes me feel like we would be an outlier. We are not current with our educational pedagogy. We are not aligned with best practices. When you look at this data, we are an outlier. And what are we going to do about that? We can continue to be an outlier, or we can open up our minds and think about changing so that it's in the best interest of number 31, number 42, and number 60. That's what we can do.
Just to add some anecdotal information on this, you'll see on the last bullet, New England Secondary School Consortium Conference. I was one of the lucky ones in the district, one of 10, that got to go to a two-day conference up in Hartford. I'm at the convention center on March 28th and 29th, I believe, were the dates. There's a few people that were there with me. Just while doing the research, now there were schools from all over New England, there were schools from Colorado, Florida, North Carolina, and a few other areas. This isn't really a data point, but just some anecdotal information for you. During those 2 days, I was in about 12 different workshops. Then obviously there's some free time and get together with some colleagues, go over plans, what you're doing in your schools. Not one school that I spoke to that was related to a middle school in any area in New England or any of the states that I referenced level for anything but math. Not one of them. And I'm not paraphrasing, those are the actual conversations that I had. Not one school could tell me that they do this in New England. I guess I did have all the data ones, right? some more data. Now, we reached out to high school for some other data because we thought that one of the things that we could show this evening was that at the high schools, and you can see in the dates, in 2011 and 12 for Stratford High and 2010 and 11, for Bunnell was when they changed the leveling or went to unleveled, non-level courses, whatever name you want to put on it, for ninth grade English language arts. At that time, you can see the discrepancies in the school of 205 to 279, and it went incrementally up over the last few years to the point where now Stratford High School has their highest amount to date of 391. Bunnell High School has 375 students signed up for AP courses, and 444 for next school year who have asked to be placed in these AP courses. And we have this tied to that rise in opportunity that students got in ninth grade or received in ninth grade, that a lot of these students were students who were never honor students before, received this opportunity, chose the honors option, and now have accelerated themselves at the high school level to the point where they're in AP courses. And the biggest part that we saw in percentages and change, we see this high increase in percentages, and there was literally no change in the amount of students that passed the AP courses. That speaks volume to me as well, is that we've increased opportunities but haven't hurt our AP numbers whatsoever. Now, what we chose to do during our last TLC meeting over at Flood a few weeks back, Ms. Bradford and I, we wrote some emails out to our staff and asked for honest feedback from teachers. And we coined it in, this is an idea, something that's on the horizon, something that we're looking forward towards next year. We have discussed this for the last 2 years, though, I will say, in both buildings. But we said, okay, during your PLC time today, take some time out and try to think of some restrictions, some roadblocks that you see. Now, every department emailed us. We went along with our assistant principals and other administrators in the district to go to these meetings and just ask flat out, what are some issues, what are concerns, what are some questions that you have? And these were the most common questions that came up.
I don't think I need to read them off to you, but a lot of it had to do with the timing, how to do this, what does opting in look like, all those types of things. What type of materials do we need? What's going to change in our daily life? Can we get some training? Can we go visit the high schools? Can we go visit some middle schools that are doing this to the area? And we have answers, and we've spoken to our staffs about all these things and have presented it to them, and we'll be able to try to disseminate some of that information to you this evening if those are questions that the committee has as well. I'm in the first part of this one. Some authentic feedback that we wanted to share with you this evening. Tracy Anderson's name is up there. I made sure I could use her this evening, if you will. Now, Tracy Anderson is a 7th grade science teacher at Worcester Middle School. She's a former Teacher of the Year, and this year she was actually named the Connecticut Science Teacher of the Year for the state of Connecticut. So Mrs. Anderson actually was one of the leaders in this, said, I wanted to try this out. I wanted to experiment with this. Now, she also wanted to be here this evening to present this to you, but she had a family obligation that she had to obviously take care of this evening. But she did give me something to read. I went through with Ms. Bradford earlier, and just bear with me, I'm going to read through it because these are her words. I didn't doctorate at all. So, I am a middle school science teacher that teaches three levels of science. One might label my three levels as an honors course, a regular or a level one course, and lastly, a lower level, or more often referred to as a level two course. In all three levels, students in the middle school science get the same curriculum topics, so ultimately they learn the same science content. How they get to the understanding and applying the content is differentiated for all students, not just for the lower level classes. Each student is unique in how they learn, and as a teacher, it is my job to discover the best ways for each and every one of my 125 students to reach the same expectation I have for the students regardless of their level. Accomplishing this allows for all students to have equal opportunities in taking part in high-level experiences. One example of a high-level experience in middle school science would be dissections. It is currently written into the honors curriculum that those students have the opportunity, only honors students, have the opportunity to experience dissections of organs that are included in the human body unit, but the other level classes, it is up to the discretion of the teacher to perform dissections or not. And that's based on behavior. I personally feel that such an experience is crucial to all young learners, whether you're my highest advanced learner or one of my lower achieving students who struggles reading at a second grade level. Again, it's my job as a teacher to find a way to differentiate the exact science content in order to deliver the same level experience to all students. Why is such an experience thought to only be for highest level students? Don't we want to show all students how amazing a career in medical field would be? Don't we want all students in our town to strive to go to college and pursue a life of success? And this is why I dissect with all of my classes and all of my students. And here's her example of what she tried out literally 2 weeks ago. Here's an example of how a teacher can take a high level lesson and differentiate it so that all students ultimately get the same experience. Taking the actual content that was necessary to understand the parts of the human heart and how it is able to continuously contract and relax, pumping deoxygenated blood in from the body cells to the lungs where gas exchange occurs, and then return the oxygenated blood back into the heart for release into the body via arteries. I had to differentiate the actual lessons, homework, learning activities, and provide the same experience to all of my students in my classes. With the use of science notebooking skills, animations and interactive websites, hands-on lessons, and various techniques I used to differentiate with my students, I was able to have all 125 of my students pass the honors level pre-dissection test with a 75 or better. Complete an advanced dissection of a sheep heart, and I went to go watch these classes, so I saw firsthand, and blood vessels, and complete a detailed honors level post-test that assessed how they met the learning objectives. These are students who never received this type of experience and were able to all 125 of the students pass because of the experience Mrs. Anderson gave them. And she ends with, when you raise the bar high and you provide necessary tools for each student to succeed, along with a positive learning environment where they are challenged and encouraged to push themselves, you can have all students achieve at a higher level. I thought it was important to read the entire thing because Mrs. Anderson has been an example for all teachers in our district, in our building, and somebody who I look to, obviously, for this evening, to be able to give me some authentic feedback. One thing that I will add, just personally, I know a lot of people here don't know a lot of my experience. Before I became an administrator, I was a business teacher. I was a high school business teacher at a few different high schools throughout the state of Connecticut, and as a specialist, if you will, as we're labeled at times, I had the class valedictorian, some of the lowest level students in my classes, some of the students who were behavioral issues in my classes, and I will tell you, that was great experience to me getting into this position as well. And obviously everyone thinks we're the best at what we do, okay, or you should. I think that I was a very good teacher, and that's why I went to a few different positions in my career so far. But it wasn't just because of my classroom management. It wasn't just because of my rapport with my students. It was also because the students held each other accountable to a standard. So if I had some students that were behavioral issues or concerns for other teachers in levels, when they came to my class, it was a different learning environment. The students who were high achievers or that class valedictorian didn't allow those things to occur because of the environment that was taking place. We made the rules together. We set the learning expectation, behavior expectations together. And that's how a classroom is run when you don't worry about leveling. And we talk to teachers, educators, etc., about who are high-level students. A lot of the things that they'll answer are about compliance. They do their homework. They hand in assignments on time. They come to school every day. We don't often talk about cognitive ability. That's something that I wanted to leave you with as well for that piece. Video.
Before we get to the video, as Mr. Darcy was sharing his personal story, I have a quick personal story as well. As a graduate of Stratford High, I can tell you firsthand, I remember vividly, I think it was 10th grade chemistry, Miss Hilly. I don't know if anyone had her as a teacher. I remember I didn't make the cut for AP chemistry. And way back then, she advocated for me. She knew that there was something internally in me, a drive, that I could handle the AP chemistry class. So what did she do? She called my mom. And she said, I'd like to have Leanne in this class. And even though she didn't meet the bar, I think that she can handle it. And so she made that exception way back when. So we can certainly do that today and allow more students the opportunity. If I could do AP chemistry without making the cut, imagine what can happen to the other students that had that opportunity. So that's just a personal story. As Mr. Darcy was talking, I remembered that. We have a very short video clip for you. This is a seventh grade classroom. It's a non-leveled ELA class. What's interesting about this video, 93% of the students are high need students. I mean, that's way more than our demographics in Stratford. So way more challenging with 93% of the students high needs. The range in the classroom goes from a second grade reading level to a seventh grade reading level. And you might be thinking to yourself, well, how can the teacher teach? Okay, but we are here to show you that it can happen. When you raise the bar, it can happen. And we have to have high quality teachers willing to embrace this, such as Ms. Hilly. So we have a few shots to show you.
Scene from the Watsons Go to Birmingham. Dad says, well, a lot of times that's going to be the way of the world for you kids. Byron is getting old enough to understand that his time for playing is running out fast. He's just got to realize that the world does not have a lot of jokes waiting for him. So this is a seventh grade class, and the students range from a second grade reading level to all the way to a seventh grade reading level. For almost all of my lessons, I do have a guided note sheet prepared for them. So those of the students who need more scaffolding, the scaffolding is built in into the guided note sheets. The second text that we read, Warriors Don't Cry, was a much higher level, more difficult text for them to get through. So prior to reading the chapters, we went over unfamiliar vocabulary that they might encounter in the text. So now it's your turn. You are going to read this quote, think about it, analyze it, and discuss what it means with your partners. So the quote says, courage, above all things, is the first quality of a warrior, by Carl von Clausewitz. Now flip your guided note sheet over. I want you now to talk to your partners, and like I did, maybe you want to underline some parts of the quotes, and talk to your partners about what you think it means.
Courage is like the basic fact of a warrior, is the first thing that comes to him.
It means that a warrior has to be ready to do something. They need the trait and courage in order to be one.
Courage is also being brave. So you need to be brave to be a warrior.
Why not charm? Why isn't charm the first quality? Or why not good look? What can that help a good a warrior?
No, cause good looks can't help a warrior. Like Melville, her good looks didn't help her survive school. Like she needed courage in order to keep going. Like after all those kids kept doing mean things to her, she had courage and stayed in school.
Excellent. I love that you brought it back to Melba. What?
There's just one more short clip that we will share with you tonight.
About the last one, 7:45?
Yes.
Evaluating, they will still need evidence. All right, I would love to hear your ideas. While I was walking around to the different tables, many of you picked different scenes of Melba showing courage. What I'd like you to do is share out the actual quote that you found from the text and then your explanation. So first, the quote. Daniel?
Suddenly I felt a sting of a hand slapping inside of my cheek, and the warming, slimy saliva on my face dropping to the collar of my blouse. I put a connection to the quote because she does not fight back, and she kept on walking. She didn't say nothing back to the children.
How does that exactly show courage?
Because if another child gets smacked and spit in the face, their natural instinct is to fight back, but that she knows with the consequences, she chooses not to fight back.
Excellent, and that's what I want you to add in the guided note sheet, okay?
I had a quote on page 149. All we saw was her wavering, and though she were trying to balance herself, when her tray went flying, chili spilled all over the two boys. This quote shows Lenny Jean, one of the nine students, was brave enough to fight back, and she had the courage to fight back.
Okay, she had the courage to fight back. Excellent.
Even if that boy Link got me later for stealing his car, I was alive and on my way for now. I put that this connects to the scene because Melba had a hard time trusting Link because of his skin color. And she thought she was going to do something bad to her, but she didn't care a lot that she was still alive.
Wow.
Okay, so that's just a snapshot of what I call high quality teaching, right? High discourse, rigor, great questioning, differentiated. And when I watch videos like this, I often think about, would I want my daughter in that classroom, right? And of course I would, because there's high quality teaching going on. I wouldn't be focused on the demographics or all of those external pieces in the whole framework that we talked about in the beginning. I see that this teacher is zeroed in on the instructional core, and that's what we want for all students. So that's just a snapshot. When you say, can this happen? It most certainly can happen, and that was a snapshot of that happening. The student and parent perspectives, we know based on our conversations with Bunnell and Stratford High that one student has progressed to taking AP courses through the opportunity and exposure of the honors option. So we know that the honors option is accelerating learning at the high school level, and it's working. There was a survey that the high schools gave in 2013. They surveyed the ninth graders in the ELA Honors Option classroom. 77% of those students reported that they were challenged in the Honors Option classroom. This is not our opinion. This is not the teacher's opinion. This is down to the student level, right? The through line is back to the student. How do they feel in that classroom? What is the impact it's having on them? And 77% said that they are being challenged. And just some parent perspectives. I mean, we encourage some of the barriers in those authentic conversations because that helps us ground our thinking and our decision making. And so when talking to parents, some of them have been very open and honest with me, and I appreciate that. And I welcome that. And some of the parents have truly said to me, I'm concerned that my child is going to be bored and they're going to be a helper for the students that are struggling. That's real. That's a real feeling that parents are having. And we want to acknowledge that because as we plan to implement this improvement strategy, that's an area that we would make sure that we address. That students are not bored, that students are not just helping other students. So please, we welcome your feedback. We respect your feelings, and it helps us ground our decision and our problem solving with this strategy.
The last few slides just talk about logistics, what this can look like. So we showed some video examples, but what we're really proposing in some logistics for next school year is that math would be continued leveled by course. And what we mean by that is, obviously it's really tough to ask a math teacher, I see one of mine sitting right there, to teach algebra or pre-algebra and geometry all in the same course. So leveling for math will continue. It has to, but it will be designated by what course those students are ready for at that moment in time. Social studies, ELA, and science would be non-levels with that honors option component, exactly designed like our current ninth grade courses at Bunnell and Stratford High School. Now, one of the things that teachers were looking at, some of the positives obviously were there, but the biggest one was, right now you'll see some classes at the middle school level where we can max out at 35. Where we max out at 35, and then you may have a period, the next period, which is 12 students. And because of the schedule, because of the leveling, as far as behavioral concerns, if there are behavioral concerns or bad makeup of students, if you will, in a class, because of being locked into levels, we aren't able to readily move students, if you will. So what this would do is try to even out classes as much as possible. And also, if you have a group of students who just aren't getting along well with each other, take some students and put them into a higher level. We've tried that at both of our schools, and that has worked every time that we have done it. I will say that as well. And make sure that they're all pushed at the same level, same quality, and behaviors will be able to have a little bit more freedom as far as setting up classes based on the behaviors, based on what the makeup of the students are. And a lot of things that the teachers gave feedback on as well is that the classroom and the students will drive the instruction as well. They're absolutely correct. So every classroom would take on a life of itself in this design, and they'd have the ability to do that. Teachers would have one lesson plan and differentiate for students. And those are things that we're doing right now as far as differentiated instruction, as far as questioning strategies as well. We teach to the higher level. So we're not teaching to the middle ground. We're not teaching to lower level and then advancing up. We're teaching to the highest level possible with the theory and practice that students will rise up to that level and expand past and beyond it, where students get that SRBI, that scientifically research-based support, if they need it in the classroom and with support staff available. We create tasks that push curriculum further for students who are ready. And as we've said throughout this a little bit, at the bottom it says teachers are already doing this themselves. Ms. Radford gave you an example of when she was at Stratford High School a few years ago. Gave you an example of when I was teaching. And some of our teachers at both middle schools and high schools are doing this right now. And that's why we wanted to give you the example of an authentic example that Tracy Anderson gave us this evening also. Implementation plan. As far as parents, guardians, what we'd like to do, obviously, have forums like this. Give this presentation out. Answer any questions that you have. Have public forums at both middle schools to explain what this would look like moving forward
be able to answer those questions very openly and honestly.
And I just want to chime in, not just answer your questions, but we are open for suggestions. I mean, we value your opinion. I mean, you're parents, you're part of the decision making. So if you have a suggestion on how we can implement this with fidelity or how we can make this work, please share that with us. I did have the opportunity to talk to one parent. I won't put her on the spot, but I will because she's smiling. My PTSA president, Mrs. Rick, and I, we had such a long, valuable conversation about this. And we agreed to disagree. And I have the utmost respect for her, and she has the utmost respect for me. But I walked away with ideas from her by listening to her, ideas on how we can move this forward. And that's what partnership is all about. So don't just come with questions. Come to us also with suggestions, because we are open to them.
Obviously, this would be something that would be on horizon for, in May, our seventh grade orientation. We provide examples of lessons, which we provided one here this evening, or two, actually, through the video and through the example. We show some schedules of what this would exactly look like. Now, as far as teachers, are they prepared? So that's the next part of this process. They've asked to observe high school teachers and middle school teachers. We're prepared to do that. That's fine. PLC time, and what the design is, and I know the timing. We're in almost, you know, middle of April, end of April, really, at this point. So what the calibration in some of the comments that you see, over the next couple of months, our teachers will work together so that that calibration, that rigor, the assessment, the honors option components, and all the designs of lessons for moving forward would be the same experience in the building and across town, if you will. And in the fall, that calibration will be continued to work on. So we're not saying the expectation to teachers and to the community and to students is that by the time we close on June 19th, I think now, that this is just done. We're ready to go in August. This is going to be an ongoing process through the calibration, through looking at assessments, through looking at data on how this is working and what assessment changes we can make. I did mention this earlier in the briefly in the presentation, the last piece of this. This aligns through everything that we're doing through the district's vision and our five-year plan. It fits in through strengthening connection. These are the four areas of the five-year plan, if you're not aware of it at this point. Strengthening connection to families and communities, mastery-based learning, 21st century skills, which is actually the one I serve on, and social and character-based curriculum. So non-leveling fits into all four of these areas and in through the vision of the district as well. If you pay attention to some of the research that we provided today, some of the things that we're trying to model for you here this evening as well.
Last slide. First and foremost, we want to thank you for your patience. This is a longer than normal presentation, but the topic is really serious, and we did not want to rush through it. We wanted to lay the foundation for you and the research so that you can make an informed decision. So we do apologize, it was a little longer than normal. Our last slide is a very quick video that talks about tracking versus detracking. And so as you're watching the video, I just want to frame you with some questions to think about as you're watching the video. As you're watching, think back to the quote by Dr. Robert Cooper from Johns Hopkins University, that very first quote that we talked about, perpetuating racial division. Do we really want to perpetuate racial division? Do we really want a North and South in Stratford? Or do we want one Stratford, one school district? As we watch our closing video, we ask you to think back to that PELP framework and the center, the instructional core, and who's first and foremost, our students. How we make decisions today will impact our future and our district. So we will end with this video. Thank you again for your patience.
Some problems with tracking is that it provides an inadequate and inequitable education to students in low-level courses. It does this by providing a weaker learning environment. Lower track classrooms are usually assigned the least experienced teachers, even though they may be assigned students with the greatest needs, who may be the most challenging to teach. Another thing is that teachers tend to have lower expectations for students in the lower tracks. Next, tracking usually widens the gap in achievement between students in the top and bottom levels over time.
The second major issue with tracking in schools is that it promotes a separation of students in integrated schools along class and racial lines. Tracking and segregation have had a long history in the United States. Early in the 1900s, there was an influx of poor rural families and increasing immigration from Eastern and Southern Europe into the United States of America. Because of this, public schools began tracking based on IQ tests. These IQ tests were biased and wound up separating students among ethnic and class lines and put the poorer students in lower tracks versus the more wealthy students in higher tracks. Eventually, we see a decrease in the importance of this until 1954, the passing of Brown versus Board of Education. Tracking and segregation appears in our education system once more and allows a de facto segregation in schools that have been forcefully integrated under the idea that separate but equal was no longer equal. Today, we see this problem persisting in many of our classrooms across the nation. In racially mixed schools, tracking usually produces resegregation of black and white students into different classes within the school, with fewer chances for minority students to progress to high school completion and college enrollment. There are preconceived notions about race, class, and intelligence, as well as lack of parental involvement and guidance counselor negligence that often leads to the misplacement of many students within tracks. In 1995, 93% of white students and 97% of Asian students who scored above 90 in national curve equivalencies were placed in gifted programs, whereas only 56% of Latinos who scored above 90 were placed in these high grouping programs. In this way, tracking tends to reproduce inequality. This reproduction produces a self-fulfilling prophecy that tells us that if students are labeled as educationally inferior or superior, that is how they will perform. Thus, tracking sends messages to students about inferiority and superiority that affects them for the rest of their lives.
Tracking has also been critiqued for perpetuating unequal access to the college-bound curriculum. Students believe tracking meant struggling students receive less rigorous and engaging teachers and curriculum. One student said, "My teacher said, well, I'll be here to go to my AP class, but you guys are going to have a substitute. I see it like, so we're not good enough that you can come to our class too? That's not really fair." In lower tracks, fewer curriculum units are covered. The pace of instruction is slower, and the curriculum is more focused on rote memorization instead of critical thinking and higher order skills. Tests and homework are also taken less seriously in lower tracks oftentimes.
We look empirically at the characteristics of children in classrooms. Children are extraordinarily diverse in all sorts of ways. And if you group them on one characteristic, you're going to have a huge amount of diversity and variation on other characteristics. So first of all, we fool ourselves into thinking that we've got homogeneous groups of students. So then when we target instruction, rather than thinking about always differentiating instruction to just recognize and acknowledge students' differences as being normal, whenever we do that targeting, we are then limiting the possibilities for learning for all of the children.
Detracking is the dismantling of ability-driven tracks and the placement of students into classes that are intentionally heterogeneous in terms of race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, perceived ability, and previous achievement.
Students within a detracked school cannot be segregated by race or class. Some ways to improve equity in untracked classrooms is by having teachers provide extra help to any students that have serious difficulties. Another way is to equip teachers with useful teaching methods, such as cooperative learning techniques that actively involve all students from a heterogeneous class in learning activities that are effective ways to improve achievement. Students should be rewarded for individual effort and progress, regardless of their starting points. Numerous studies have shown the positive effects of detracking in schools.
So let's look at a couple of those studies. The first one was conducted in the US by Carol Burris, Jay Hubert, and Hank Levin. So in that study, they followed students over 3 years when they were in tracks in middle school, and then their school's untracked, and they continued to follow students for the next 3 years. And when they were doing that, all of the students were taking the highest level work in those untracked classes. And what they found was the untracked students achieved more. They took more advanced courses, and they passed the state exams a year earlier than the students who worked in tracks. And those advantages were across the achievement range.
In one New York high school, after detracking, the region's diploma rate rose from 58% to 96%. After detracking, the percentage of Black and Latino students who were IB diploma candidates nearly tripled. The gap between minority and white students' graduation rates decreased from 56% to 4%.
After examining all of the issues tracking creates, it is important to make detracking successful. Some ways we can do this is by hiring and retaining only those teachers who believe that all students deserve access to your school's best curriculum. It is also essential that principals do all they can within their schools to level their playing field and ensure that all students have equitable learning opportunities. Detracking is a lot of work and it requires long-term commitment to the school.
Again, we thank you for your time, your patience. Thank you. Okay, we are going to open the floor up for questions, concerns, again, suggestions, because ultimately everyone in this room, because you have committed to being here, we all care about our school district and what's best for our district. So if we, I don't know who wants to start or...
No questions, right?
Or no questions.
Even better.
All right, Helen Tucker.
I was just wondering with the honors options. Okay, we're going from sixth grade where we really don't, I mean, you know some of the kids are really bright, some of them have, need extra help. But how are we going to encourage kids to take the honors option in seventh grade? Because a lot of times, you guys know it, with the hormones in the schools, you got 500 kids in there who are.
So I think,
and I'm trying to say for the parents, for the parents' help too, are we going to be really trying to talk to the kids and or the parents to say, I really believe this kid can handle honors. And the follow-up is that, and the reason why I'm asking is, again, for preparation for high schools, because let's face it, colleges still use AP, they still use honors. They want to see those things on the records. So that's why I'm asking, how is this going to happen for seventh grade?
Great question. And so what I will say, and I know Mr. Darcy, we're probably going to both answer every question for everyone. It starts at the ground level with the teacher. It's all about the relationship and the rapport. The teacher knows which students need to be pushed. Think about the example I gave with Ms. Hilly. Knowing who I was as a student, no matter what those scores said, she knew that I could handle that. So we are going to be leaning on those sixth grade teachers and really pushing them to think outside the box and say, who else would you recommend? Who else has that internal drive? And really having those authentic conversations with teachers about how we want to increase the number of students taking the honors options. It starts with the classroom teacher, and then the teacher reaching out to the parent and saying, let's sit down and talk about your son or daughter, because I think they have a lot of potential, and I'd like to recommend your family choose that honors option. That's how I see us playing it out.
Into the point that you made about that, I've been at the high school level most of my career, well, all of my career other than the last 2 years, to be honest with everyone here. And you're correct that they're going to look at those things. And we showed with some of the data that we showed today that because of the detracking, non-leveling in ninth grade, that students are opening their eyes and getting those opportunities and getting those AP courses, getting those credits, getting college paid for when it's so expensive. And those are going to be discussions that we're going to have
to educate both parents, teachers, and students alike in the seventh grade, because we want the students coming into seventh grade understanding where they're going to be 4 or 5 years down the road because of the opportunities that we're opening up to them. I don't want people thinking that we're limiting our students. We are expanding opportunities for all of our students with the idea that every student that enters our buildings in seventh and eighth grade next year has the ability to access the highest level of education opportunity that we can give at Worcester or Flood.
I have kind of a follow-up, I hope you don't mind, but I'm thinking of the emotional point of the child, and I have to use as reference my child, who had a terrible time in seventh and eighth grade, basically fell off the wagon emotionally, mm-hmm. and that makes it very difficult. She didn't learn much in seventh and eighth grade, I'll be frank. And that can happen, and I know I've seen it with other kids too. How can we work with those kind of kids? Because we know that if they lose it then, it takes a while for them to get back on track.
And we have obviously social workers, we have support staff available, guidance counselors and everything like that to handle some of those, obviously things that happen within the school environment. But to also speak to your point, just to give an example of the high schools as well. When they go into an honors option, they have, I think it's 2 weeks to really get into the honors option part of the curriculum. Now, if you do that into the high school level, you're sort of locked in, if you will. At the middle school level, we believe you have the ability to take those honors components throughout the school year. When you are ready for it, you're accessing that part of the curriculum. So you're not locked in, if you will. So if you do have a student who is going through something emotionally and needing some support, obviously we know that there are times where, bottom line is, sometimes education has to take a back seat, if you will, to some of the emotional supports that we see in our students every day.
Can you explain the honors option a little more? I follow the non-leveling, mm-hmm. but how does that work?
As far as just logistically?
Yeah, signing up. Well, and once they've decided, yes, I want to have an honors option, does that happen doesn't that kind of level them?
It allows students to have that access that they're getting into that honors option. You're correct. But currently, students in seventh and eighth grade, parents are able to opt kids into those levels, and then they're only in honors or only in level one. In this design, students would be grouped together and be able to access that high level. So how we would look at this is a teacher is teaching to a high level, and then you're differentiating on tasks that the students are doing. So you may have students who are doing certain projects that reach a higher level than other students who might need some support in the classroom themselves. But there may be a time during the year where a student would say, I'm ready to access some of that honors and take some of those components of the next few tasks or projects, if you will.
Susan? We never mentioned on special ed students, and I know like IEPs, special ed students need to have some of the hours every single week. How would you propose that we would service these students?
That doesn't change. The service delivery would still continue. The special education teachers would still have collaborative classrooms where they're going in and supporting students. The other thing that Mr. Darcy and I talked about is that we as a district have to build the capacity of our regular ed teachers, because they are also responsible for that IEP. And so as we move in this direction, if we move in this direction, it's a shared responsibility as a teacher. I mean, I know when I was a teacher and I collaborated with Terry Aurelia, we both tried to meet the goals and objectives on that IEP, because Mrs. Aurelia wasn't in the room at all times, so the teacher is also responsible to carry those goals and objectives out. We need to increase that bar and raise that capacity and awareness for our regular education teachers. But service delivery would not change.
In hours.
Mm-hmm. So if you're a special ed teacher and you have, right now, if you're in a collaborative model where mm-hmm. you have to have one more regular ed student than you do special ed students, mm-hmm. Those of us who are in education know that. So if you have 14 students that need to be serviced in language arts, they need to be serviced in language arts. So you
would all those students be in one class, or would they be?
No.
Okay, so then how, and even though you say the regular ed teacher is responsible, as a parent, if I had a special ed student, I would want to make sure my student is being serviced by a special ed teacher according to their IEP. So that's
they
a concern
will.
That
they
I have.
Would
they
still.
Because in addition to the collaborative model, Mrs. Lance, they also, some students have pull-out hours as well. So if they aren't serviced in the collaborative model, they would go into the learning center.
Research support
resource. But they definitely, I mean, by law, we have to make sure that we're meeting the needs of their IEP, and we will. We both have also special education CIAs in our building that also provide service to students with IEPs. It's a great question, but I don't see that as a barrier
or obstacle
in preventing this work.
Tanya?
Mark, I had a comment and a question. As a parent of students in three different levels, if a student is leveled in middle school, it's nearly impossible, especially on the lower level, for them to get into AP or honors courses in the high school. And that goes to say for the students who may have had an emotional seventh and eighth grade year, and say something happened in their family, there's something that went on, they get to high school, now everything is, they're sorted out. It's nearly impossible for them to go up another level. And it traps our students, it labels our students. As a parent of a student that's in 10th grade, I had such a hard time pushing for my child to get into higher level classes, because they look back at where the student took classes at in middle school, elementary school, where they tracked. And you, as a parent, you have to advocate so strongly for your student. And I think it's just really unfair, especially when the achievement gap in Stratford has been the way it has been for so many years. The achievement gap has been very high for the minority students in Stratford. And this leveling has really kept our students back for so long. And this new model, as far as it raises the bar for a student, for all students, it's not, we're not lowering, I don't look at this as a lowering of standards. It's raising the bar for all students to come up instead of giving them the option to stay down. Because if we give them the option, there's some students, they're kids, they're children. They're going to take that option.
That's right.
You know, they're going to stay there. And then what happens is they get into high school, they stay there, they take remedial courses, and they can't graduate, or they can't pass the CMTs, they can't get into college, they go to community college, they can't pass the entrance exam, and they just stay stuck. So I really think that we need to focus on what are we doing for our students. And I forgot what my question was.
We'll take it.
First of all, I'd like to say that I am a member of the board because my children were educated in this community, and the educational system well served all three of them. Second of all, I'd like to say that I obviously, with all my heart, support the system being exceptionally careful with being equitable for all our children. But as a teacher who is, you know, I've taught for about 30 years now, and I've been faced with elimination of levels. I teach 11th grade American literature. And the problem emerges when we have AP and then honors and then American Lit and we're told to differentiate. My concern is that the implementation of this program is happening pretty quickly. And while time is of the essence, I worry about our educators feeling comfortable enough to provide that differentiation in a classroom. When we say there's one lesson, I respect that, but it really isn't one lesson, because I go home and rack my brains to create multiple lessons to meet the needs of all my kids. Today, I introduced a novel near and dear to my heart, To Kill a Mockingbird, and I said, I want you to jump on board. I want you really to, you know, take this novel and love it like I do. Put it under your pillow. And they looked at me like, really, lady? We have two more reads plus you just gave us. And I said, it's only 176 pages. And I said, but I don't have my reading glasses on. And one kid looked over and goes, no, it's 376. I said, I love it. I just love it. And so in my differentiated classroom, my kids, they've touched me, because my guesstimate was that only a small percentage was going to opt to read the book as an extra read. And I got 3/4 of my kids in that classroom. So I'm not saying this is not going to work ultimately, but what I am saying is that teachers need time to very adequately prepare for this. So I don't see, I myself cannot see supporting this in the fall because I feel it doesn't give educators enough time to be acquainted with the differentiation process. I really do.
What I would say, and I know you might want to jump in as well, is that that is a real concern that was shared with us from teachers. We're not hiding that fact. But what I would say also is when you're making any type of change that is a mind shift to what we currently do, it's going to be uncomfortable for people because it's a change. So it's either going to be uncomfortable now or 3 months from now, 6 months from now, 2 years from now, whenever it's going to be. Everyone collectively on both our staffs and in the educational community agrees that this is the right thing to do. That's why we're here in urging this as something that has to be done. But what I would say, ultimately, as far as timing is concerned, as I said before, training has to occur. Teachers are already asked to differentiate. We're already working on differentiation and questioning strategies and everything else for the last few years that we've been in charge of both of our schools. And that this would be an ongoing process. Whether we level or not, this happens throughout PLC time, throughout time in our classrooms, throughout time in our staff meetings. So this is something that we've actively been working on.
Respectfully, you want to meet the needs of all kids. Teachers have to be more than adequately trained for this. And as a parent of kids who have gone through the system, I have to tell you, there was a portfolio program implemented at one point in the school system. It was implemented quickly without proper training. And my son, who was in middle school, would come home and he thought it was a great, you know my son. My baby is my social character.
Well, what's your son's
name? Patrick.
Last name?
Patrick.
Oh, of course.
Oh, yes. Of course. So he was my, he's a police officer now.
Congratulations.
But he was my social kid. So he would come home in the afternoon and I would say, how'd school go today? And he'd say, it went really well, Mom. And I'd say, what did you do today? Well, I went to this class. How come you didn't go to history? Well, I was locked out. Excuse me? Well, you know, you decide, basically, the kids were kind of at the wheel, helping drive the decision of what classes they wanted to go to, and when a class was full, well, then the door was shut. And so that was a program that was implemented. Yeah. It was here.
That's fun.
It was fun.
It's not
fun your time.
It was fun.
Okay? So by like the third time that my son came home and said, I went to art and I went to math and I went to, and I know my Patrick. I went to art and I went to math and I went to history and I went to, Patrick, you go to language arts today? I'm going to do that probably tomorrow. Excuse me? So I remember calling a Board of Ed member and saying, this is just defies my imagination. And I said, I think that you need to talk directly to my son because I can't answer all these questions. And when he talked to Patrick, his jaw hit the ground. So while portfolio, the intention was wonderful, it was supposed to best serve the needs of all the kids by letting the kids have a greater voice in what they wanted to partake of, but it was implemented too quickly without enough buy-in for the educators and experience for the educators.
Let me answer your question, and please tell Patrick I said hello. First and foremost, for everyone, including you, you have to understand that we have had ongoing training since the onset of Dr. Robinson and Dr. Gaeta. They have really brought the instructional core to a different level in Stratford. So the work that we're doing with the Connecticut Center for School Change, they have coaches on site working with us, showing us what does good teaching look like, what is differentiation, what is questioning. So we have been preparing for this. This is not just turn the lights on, we're gonna do non-leveling. For the past 3 years, and I credit Dr. Robinson and her work and Dr. Gaeta, we've been preparing for this.
I credit Dr. Robinson and Dr. Gaeta
as well. I really do. But change comes incrementally.
Mm-hmm.
We talked to Harold, and the scores are up, and that's it's a work in progress. And he's very comfortable and assertive and said it comes in increments.
Mm-hmm.
If we get approval on this, we have a plan to train the teachers during the next, I think there's still 3 or 4 PLC days that we have embedded in our calendar.
Respectfully, I don't think that's a lot of time.
It's not, but that's what I meant on one of the slides. That's to prepare on the calibration moving forward in the fall. And then next year in PLC times, during the fall, winter, etc., that's when they're going to continue their calibration process throughout the year.
So you're saying that your mission is to make this happen in the fall.
I'm sorry?
Your mission is to make this happen in the fall. I just want to understand.
Yes.
With 3 or 4 training sessions for teachers.
Well, no, it's been 3 years of training. Yeah. I don't know, Dr. Vayner or Dr. Robinson, if you want to chime in.
Yeah, and this wasn't like a... I gotcha moment to teachers either. I've been discussing this in my
building. I don't think it's an I gotcha moment. I just think as an educator, when I look at differentiation, it's an incredible workload. Mm-hmm. It is an incredible workload on educators. And they need time to
support. That we've been trained on for 3 years now. So if you take the 3 years of training and then we focus and with a laser-like focus during those PLC days, I think that they...
Do your surveys indicate that the majority of your staff are comfortable with this for the fall?
Well,
we
just went around and spoke to them informally.
That might be something that would be helpful.
We could survey them, absolutely. Absolutely, we would be honored to do that.
All right, the next question is Mrs. Lance, and then after Mrs. Lance, I have 2 questions.
I have 2 points. My son was in that portfolio program and he thrived. It was the best thing they ever did for Matthew Lance, and he's a teacher today. But it was wonderful, and he had the tools that he needed to be successful in that. My other big concern is that there are a lot of parents in this room today. There's obviously a lot more parents who are concerned, and the first I heard about it was on Facebook. So to hear about the changes that are coming for 3 years that we've been talking about, that teachers have been trained, and for the parents to hear about it for the first time, I have a concern with that, because September is coming soon. We hear that we have PLC days, professional development. Well, we all know that it's a time of year now when there's so much going on and the teachers are not as engaged, I believe, now as they would be if they were given more time to work on this plan. So that's short and sweet what I want to say. I could say a lot more.
Okay, my 2 questions, going back to this honors option.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I just want to say for the record, I'm not from the area, so my children didn't all go to chapel, but they went for a short period. Otherwise, my children went to other schools. So I don't have the experience, per se, that a lot of you have being in the Stratford school system. I'm also from a full Catholic background, Catholic school, all-girl high school. So again, I'm coming from a different mindset.
Mm-hmm.
Your honors option in, say my child decides I want to go into honors option and they want to push themselves. Once they're in past the 2-week mark or anything like that, or the next year, they decide, you know what, I really worked very hard this 1 year in this option and I got through it, but maybe I think I need to back a little.
Yeah.
How can they back out of this?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
And that doesn't change the instruction in the classroom either.
Okay.
So the supports and what type of classroom instruction is occurring does not change regardless of an honors option or not taking an honors
option. So talking to the teacher with the child, you know, and the parent.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll have that kind of a conference.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, the children, because during, no offense, but middle school, you Connecticut schools, you have a lot of children all the same age, a lot of hormones.
Mm-hmm.
You don't break it up so that there's little groups all over.
Yeah.
When a child gets very stressed, and you don't know when they're going to get stressed, sometimes being in a pressure classroom, it's it's tough.
Right.
So how, you know, how do they handle this?
First and foremost, that exists now. I mean, I've had two students that have, with their parents and the child, the family, we sat down and we took them out of the honors classroom because they were stressed and the pressure. And that's absolutely, it's an option now, and it will be an option if we move this forward.
And in this non-leveling, nobody in the classroom would kind of like know that they have been moved one level down or one differentiating down, you know, unlike being in the ALPS program,
right,
or you're going out for special,
right, yeah, yeah,
because the children do know when you're being
right
done. My second question is, because you're correct, this is something that's being rolled out, and I can see the benefits and I can see the non-benefits,
mm-hmm,
would it be prudent to have what I would call mock forums, you know, in your schools for the parents to see how something like this would work,
mm-hmm,
so that they can audit, you know, a classroom being taught for math or science or English, so they can be the ones to say, oh, okay, I see what you're saying now. I see how you're taking the three different groups. I would do something like that. Well, I'm just saying for your PTAs or something like that, like on a PTA night, have mock setups so that the parents can go to a classroom and say, right, have them do a lesson, have them do it so that they can see that this is something I can now wrap my brain around, because, you know, I love PowerPoint and stuff, but unless you physically are in there and see it, and I think something like that between now and maybe June to let them all know and give them more information, I just don't see one presentation having us look at this and then vote on it. I'd like to see it for September, and I like the fact that it would be an ongoing progress, which any good program should be, because it has to be flex and bend, has to be, you know, geared towards all the different levels of students. As both my kids, I have one that's on one end and one on the other end. And to be honest with you, it was not an easy thing going through the regular one-size-fits-all curriculum. So what I've been seeing since Dr. Robinson and Dr. Gaeta have been here is a real change in teaching to kids and how they want to be taught, because it's how they think. It's not just a textbook and stuff. So for me, I think the mock classroom thing might be good for the parents so that they get more of a gist of what you're trying to get across. So
I'm sure we have teachers that would be willing to volunteer to do this mock classroom.
I would even
open it up to the families, to the community, all stakeholders.
Yes, I think so.
For buy-in, absolutely.
I really do. Between now and June,
we could make that happen.
That would be good.
I just want to say, like, again, what you were saying about this has been in progress for many years, 3 years or plus. There have been a lot of parents, minority parents, that have come to this Board of Ed, that have come to this district, have met with Dr. Robinson, Dr. Gaeta, that have said these numbers for minority students is just unacceptable. And so when we say, let's wait another year, let's wait another 2 years, let's do a, you know, this is unacceptable when you have a child that is consistently in these numbers, 33% and failing, and there's nothing being done. I've met with Dr. Robinson, Dr. Gaeta, come to the Board of Ed and said something has to be done to close this achievement gap in this town. And if it's not this, then there needs to be something else done, because this town is very diverse. It's getting more diverse. We have 49 different cultures in here, which means if we don't address this issue and we continue to level our students, that achievement gap is going to continue to climb. And while we're talking about, you know, the teachers, and I understand that. My mother was in special ed for many years. I understand that as a teacher, this may be difficult, but our goal is to educate all of our students in Stratford, make sure all of the students are being challenged. And one of the reasons why many parents have taken their children out of Stratford to other districts, me personally have looked into it, went and visited other districts, because that was my feeling, that our students are not challenged the same way. When you go to other districts, they don't do that. And, you know, that was a question that I had for other districts. I went to several other districts and I found out, how would you place my student? Oh, we're going to place them, you know, we place them all together, and then we see where they go from there. But this leveling thing, where we level them and we put them in here and there, it's a huge disservice to our students. It really is. And especially, like I said, with this town becoming more and more diverse, if we want our students to stay here, if we want a diverse population in our students, we have to create an environment that tells those parents, tells minority parents, look, your child is going to be educated to the highest level that we have to offer here. I think that's really important, because a lot of the parents are feeling that. You know, there's a lot of parents that would have been here, but they're working and, you know, they're taking care of other family obligations. But for myself personally, I really feel like something has to be done in order to get these numbers to climb, because the numbers are climbing. But for the minority students, that there's still a huge gap that is not being addressed. And that's my issue. You know, we're going, there's parents that constantly send emails, they talk. I encourage them to reach out to the administration to say these things. But time is going by, and these students are, if they don't get it in the seventh grade year, they're going to eighth grade, they get to high school, and then it's too late. And we're doing a huge disservice. So that's just the point I wanted to make.
David, do you have a question?
A comment and then a question through the chair to the superintendent.
Okay, sure.
I've been lucky enough to be a member of this committee, as many members know, for 10 years. This is one of the finest presentations that I've sat through in those 10 years.
Thank you.
But I want to, the reason that's not just a, you know, because it's a nice thing to say. It's filled with data. It's looking forward. It is time for our district to move on this. Been a member of the Achievement Gap Task Force since 2012. You have taken the principles and adapted to our culture. But what's more important, and it really to me, Maria and Sue in some ways, what I saw in the presentation tonight was an exceptional style and an acceptance to make this work, given the take. Now, I'm not smart enough to know whether 4 training sessions is enough, but what I saw a slide say, that this is going to be constantly refined. I saw in your leadership tonight a style that says, we're open to making this work. In business, you are constantly improving, changing. You never, ever do anything that, and day one, that it's going to be the same thing and day whatever. And I saw a style tonight that allows that dialogue. I'm impressed beyond compare for our district and the excitement that it holds. You know, my very simple comment after all that, it's time. We've got to do it. And I don't think there's too much downside to it, especially in the way that you've done it. My question through the chair to the superintendent then is, how do you feel, Janet, about the timing and all of that, and what reassurance can you give us? Or comments?
I wanted to talk. I'm going to back up before I answer your question. First of all, I taught gifted education. I typically had a 5th, 6th grade combination. Every child in that room in California, it was an IQ test. Every child in that room was above 132 IQ. They were all smarter than I am, you know, and I learned so much from them. But what I learned was all kids deserve gifted education. And when I put that in place in other districts, that's the expectation, lo and behold, they rise to it. They rise to it. And what gifted education is it's not more quantity of work. What it is conceptualizing on a high level, thinking deeper about things. We've been working, this is our 4th year now, we've been working on questioning techniques. You know, so the teachers don't, here's the difference. You know, I say, okay, what's the answer to 2 + 2? You give me the right answer, and I say, great, and I go on. No, what we do is we say, how did you get to that question, or get to that answer? Is there another way to do it? You know, you ask more and more questions, deeper understanding. So we've done a couple things. We have, number one, we have been writing our curriculum as conceptual, concept-based curriculum. So we've been working on that, and this is our 4th year of that. We have introduced new instructional strategies, and we're monitoring those all the time. And the instructional strategies means we teach differently. It's no longer teacher on the stage talking with, you know, to the whole group for the entire time. It is diversifying the activities. I went to a classroom recently, they were all reading the same current event article, but they were all reading it at the reading level. And then they had a very rich discussion in groups about that current event, even though some of those kids, there was a great variety, the span of the reading levels was as great as the one we saw here, or greater, but they were all able to discuss the content of that current event article and what the implications were. So when we start talking about, you know, the whole leveling thing, it's to provide gifted education to all students. You know, one of the districts I was challenged said, we want you to raise all of our students' scores, the very metric oriented, to be within the top third in our DIRG, top three in our DIRG. And it, by combining the rigorous curriculum with the instructional core that we were talking about before, with those intersect, getting people to the point where they knew how to do that, teachers knew how to do that. We had on this, that was CMT at that time, out of the 16 CMT strands, we were within the top three in 14 out of the 16 in every grade level, and we were number one in three of those. And that was not teaching to the test. That was helping kids learn to think and answer and feel confidence in their ability to perform in the classroom. And that's what we want to build, is that confidence, that love of learning. So, yeah, we've got a long road to go. What we've worked on for the last 3 years has been developing differentiation as part and parcel of what we have to do. Is it a struggle for some of us old timers who've been around for a long time? Yeah, and that's not you, that's me. but you know, it people are beginning to see it work, and they're getting that confidence about the work. So that had to happen before we got to the point when we started talking about unleveling. And you've been very patient with me, Tania, as I've tried to deal with this, getting to this point. I do believe we're at the point now we've got to kickstart it and say, okay, now we're ready for this next move. And it's been hard to hold back. But you know, to not push things as fast as I would like to have pushed. But I really think at this point that our schools are ready, and we already have the track record of the unleveled classes at the high school, which have been that way since NEAS made you do it. But it's worked. It's working. And you'll see that we have more kids taking AP classes at the high schools now than we had before. And that's what we want to do. I want to see more kids succeeding, more kids in higher level. I want to challenge kids. So that's my little speech. But it's about doing what's right for kids.
A couple things. I have the honor, I guess, of having a son who was in when the change happened at Pinnell. And it started with, it was social studies. And they were unleveling social studies, and all the parents were up in arms. How dare they do that? Anyone that knows my two children know that my daughter was type A, high achiever, and my son, that's one. However, because of that class, he ended up with students that were go-getters, that were those highly academic kids that he aligned himself with for the next 4 years, and then actually did take a couple AP classes senior year, to all of our amazement, where she didn't take AP classes. So I have firsthand knowledge of watching the two of them that made a huge difference. She got demotivated by being in the high level classes freshman sophomore year, and he got motivated by being in mixed groupings. So, you know, as a family consumer science teacher, I totally get that differentiation part. But the second piece is with my administrator hat on. I've been at a school for the last 16 years that stopped leveling 14 years ago. And we, middle school, and we have seen, when you look at our testing data, we've really leveled things out. And we are a high, I mean, we were set up to be highly diverse. And it's working. Yes, I have the same concern that Maria has, that differentiation is hard. And it takes a lot of work, and teachers have to be comfortable with it. But differentiation is not a new concept. And all of us that have dealt with differentiation know that, like she said, it puts, you have to put a lot of time into finding the resources and getting the support. But it sounds like as a school, as schools, you're both willing and able to do that. And it's a work in progress. I don't think this is going to, you know, when it gets implemented, poof, everything's going to be wonderful right away.
It's a process.
But I think in the process, we will start start closing that gap, because I agree, those numbers are awful and shouldn't be there.
And I will just comment on Robin's statement saying that her school stopped leveling 14 years ago. Okay, and so when Mr. Kennedy talks about it's time, 14 years. A lot of these districts have stopped this antiquated process years ago. And so I think that was an important statement to make. And thank you for sharing those.
And because we're an inter-district school, many of those kids are Stratford kids that have grown up that way.
Respectfully, I think if you want to promote rigor and equitable circumstances for all children, which I in my heart totally support, agree, believe in, is fundamental to my being. I love the profession of teaching. I'm a very dedicated, devoted teacher. I would give anything to see my children be successful. Respectfully, I believe that to see a program flourish, because you don't want to implement something and find out, and this is my concern, it is implemented really quickly, and okay, so here's been groundwork for which I haven't been privy to because I'm new to the board, okay? But respectfully, if we want kids to flourish and we want to raise the bar really high and we want to promote rigor for all kids, we have to make sure that our educators are comfortable with their situations to make this work. And as an educator, I think I speak for many. We all want what's in the best interest of our kids, and we all want to. I go home and I reevaluate what I do on a daily basis. I drive my car and I turn the radio off and I think, you know what, this worked beautifully today. You know what, this didn't work so beautifully today. I need to reinvent, maybe go back and tweak this and fix it. But rigor is at the heart of my philosophy. I just would hate to see, because I've seen it happen under your guidance, I've seen it happen in Stratford on more than one occasion before, when a program has been implemented that sounds wonderful, but it never really takes flight the way it's supposed to, because your educators are not ready for it. That's the point I'm trying to make.
So
reading each other's minds.
I mean, I respect everything that you're saying, and I think the piece that's missing that we can provide the committee with is really the training that has led up to this. Because you said you're not familiar with all that we've been provided, the hands-on training and our work with the Connecticut Center for School Change and the teacher survey. Maybe those materials
teacher
and research.
Survey.
Will kind of help drive your decision making.
And what I would say is, look, we've said that we've been talking about this for a few years. Teachers have known, and I don't want it to come across as we're trying to push this, and maybe that's what it seems like at this point in the school year. We have seen, we understand the district and the 5-year commitment that we've been making through the process right now. We know some initiatives that are coming along the lines over the next few years. And what we're trying to avoid is 2 to 3 years down the road doing 4 or 5 different things at once and saying good luck. This is an incremental shift or step in that direction that we have seen and that we've worked on the PD and everything else over the last few years. And the other thing that we've done when we've tried to discuss this with teachers and with parents alike, is that we've been very careful of saying, you know, just like when you speak about politics, that this is what I believe in and what we're doing and what we have to do. We're trying to leave our personal beliefs out of that discussion. If we, when we took over as principals, wanted our personal beliefs to be followed, we would have done this 2 years ago. It would have just been done on day one. But we understand that planning has to happen, and it has been ongoing. We understand that those, and as you said, as an educator, regardless of level, if you're a great educator, which we have a ton of great educators in our schools, you're doing that reflection process no matter what, whether you're teaching a level one, a level two, there are level two classes at the high school level, honors, non-level, etc. That reflection process happens already. So we really don't look at this as a, I think we look at this as a shift in how we're looking at things in our minds, but on a day-to-day, because of the collaborative environments we have in our school system, in our schools, how we work so well together, that we don't see this as a huge undertaking. We see this as an incremental change that we've been doing over the last few years, that if the most, and we wouldn't be bringing this in to you in April if we didn't have passion for this, obviously, as well as you saw in our presentation this evening and some of the comments that you've heard here today. But also because that if we are uncomfortable with this, that doesn't mean we shouldn't do it. If it's the best thing for our students, based on research, and that's what I mean. I would bet that if you surveyed all of our teachers in our buildings, a very, very high percentage, if not all of them, would say this is the right thing to do. I understand that how you implement it makes people uncomfortable. And we recognize that, and that's why we're saying that whether we implement this, or we had this discussion or this presentation now, or 6 months ago, or 2 years ago, or whatever it was, that process would be a continuum regardless. That's why we're comfortable with this.
I wish it was 6 months ago. Yeah, I just wish it was 6 months ago, because I can't. This is my biggest issue, but it's not October right now.
And I know I didn't have the floor, I'm sorry. But that's the one thing that I'm having a hard time with, that it's not October right now. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about this.
What I'd like to put my couple of cents in, as a sitting board member, I'd like to say a couple of things. One, all right, you have two middle school principals here showing leadership, so this falls basically on them. And there is some information that they are lacking and that they should present to the to this committee and to the board. I think as leaders of their schools, they should present to us the training that they've had for 3 years. That's the gap we don't have. That 3 year training would sit well with me if I knew what you were doing over the last 3 years. This is not to task you, this is to say, this is what I need as a board member to go forward. The training would be good. The teacher survey would be good. All this gives me information that I get it, it's the way we go now. When you read the social media, then you can respond to people and say, well, for 3 years, under the guidance of, I'll just say, Dr. Gata and the superintendent, we've had this training, and this is why we're coming forward now at this time. This is what 80% of my building says as teachers, okay? The other thing I want to comment on, so I need those two things, training and supervision, please. I'd also like to, we have seen, and Mrs. Livingston has done a tremendous job in bringing this point, is that the honors option is an exceptional program. I think that is, I try not to do this, but I will do this. I will say this, my first child didn't come up through the OPS program. She was child 31 or 45 or 60, okay? In that process, when she got to one of the local high schools here, she was given the option starting an English class, and from that option, she morphed into honors and OPS course, honors and AP courses all the way till she graduated. That was an opportunity. As a minority parent, as a parent in the school district, I want the best for my child. I also understand the achievement gap. Now, my children have been blessed enough to not necessarily fall into that achievement gap because their grades are a little higher, but we are in that grouping. Now, for all the parents who are not here, and it doesn't just mean the Black and Hispanic parents that are here, ladies and gentlemen, if you have not seen the new website, there is an exceptional button where you click on it and says, now, we will decipher in any language that you come into in our school district. That is very different from 20 years ago when I first moved here. That is very different from when my parents were born here in 1947, both of them. So Stratford has changed demographically. So now we are translating into more than 49 different languages. Please go see the website. So our achievement gap is not just Black and Hispanic. It spans the generations of people who are moving into our school district. So we do have a serious issue that we must address. And it does start, we can address it at the seventh grade level, but the conversation starts in elementary. And parents from elementary go, oh my God, I don't want to talk about this, but you need to talk about it now, ladies and gentlemen. And for all the parents who legitimately have questions about behavior, it is incumbent upon at least the middle school principals to debunk, demystify, to talk about those behaviors. So when parents have that conversation on Facebook, your charge is to have those discussions in the schools, upfront, impersonal, very personal with the parents, and say, yes, we cannot control everything, but we have seen some market changes in children who do come into these classes. So I am for the honors option. I do have some trepidations about implementation, but that falls upon you and the assistant superintendent, because I'm a board member, and that's your job, is to sell me, then to sell the community, ladies and gentlemen. And understand that I am for honors option. I am for, I believe, understanding non-leveling, but it's how you present it and how it comes out. And it has to make sense to people that they can get their mind around it and understand that you're not bringing down the level of education, but everybody in that classroom will be educated. And when there are issues, as Mr. Darcy has said, when we have 35 people in the honors English class at Worcester, and there's only 12 in the other class, our teachers are equipped. And that was the other thing, professional development. You have to sell me. Yes, I was a former teacher for a very short period of time. You have to sell me on professional development. And that's, training is key. Mm-hmm. Change is tough, but training is very key. Mm-hmm. So we need to see the training to understand it. As a committee and as a board, and then the community has to understand, how much training have you had in 3 years? And can your teachers just say, for instance, on September 1, run with this program and make it happen? Because I do remember the portfolio plan, and it didn't work as well as they thought it was going to work. So at the end of the day, this falls back on a lot more people if this plan doesn't work, ladies and gentlemen. Mm-hmm. So I don't mean to stand on the soapbox, but there are some things here specifically that I want to see happen. It can happen expeditiously. Give me the information, and it can be disseminated to the people. We can then talk about the differences.
Kind of really building on that, Eric, but with a slightly different twist. I'm concerned about time. This would have been easier if we had tabled it last time, so it was our decision to table it and all of that, so we did.
Another month. One of the things that the committee might consider, if indeed we vote to forward this to the board for its consideration, I think you have answered tonight, at least for me, the why. The why now is not yet been answered. Mm-hmm. That is something that could really be presented at the board level, because I think that's the main issue tonight. You made the case for the why.
I think if I can just expand on the why now.
I don't think you don't need to answer that for me, but I'm just saying for the board. I'm interested in it. I'm just trying to move it to a level of
an
action item.
I just thank you for an opportunity just to remind the board, because you've all seen, or this committee, most members on this committee have seen the recent revisions, and Dr. Robinson alluded to that, for our curriculum, both in English language arts and in social studies, just redone. Each one of those units already contains an honors option written into it. That work has been done. our teachers have seen that now. This is their second year that they've seen it. They're still learning about it. They're still looking at how to best implement that. And then the great thing about the PLC days is the superintendent has insisted that each school, these schools are partnered. The teachers from the English department at one school meet with the teachers from the English department at the other school. They're together on those days. This is not happening in isolation. We have instruction rounds that we're doing in the district so that we visit schools as administrators, and some schools are even doing instructional rounds with teachers to visit classrooms. So you have somebody like a Tracy Anderson who teachers can go in and see this happening in the building. And then just last of all, as somebody who taught at the middle school level for 18 years, there's a lot of change that happens with students over that time. Anybody who has a middle school child knows that. But if we do not, I firmly believe that if a child gets into a class and then 2 or 3 weeks in, a teacher says, you know, do you want to consider the honors option? This is what that looks like. A child now has established a relationship with the teacher, understands what the expectations are, and may give it a try. And what they couldn't do maybe in seventh grade, they can do in eighth grade. There's a great deal of change that happens at that level. So just some things to keep in mind.
Any other questions?
I just have one other point. One thing that Stratford is missing that a lot of other districts have is they have a lot of districts have an expectation for all students, high expectation. That was something that was very attractive to me when I went to other districts to check them out. Is one of the things that they say that's consistent with all their schools is at this school, in this district, we expect all our students to be high achievers. We don't have that in any of our schools. Like, it varies from each school to which school, you know, and I've asked different administrators, well, what is your mission? What is the goal of the school? You know, some of them have to be kind, and we have this, and we have this, but what about high expectations for all students? What about expecting all of our students to be high achievers, to be high learning? That would set such a tone in our district for people coming into the district, for students that are already in the district, to boost confidence, to make us feel like, you know what, our students are going to go into the school no matter what level they're on. They're going to get into a classroom and they're going to be pushed to the highest level possible. That is something I think that is just should be standard. Like you said, there's schools that have done away with this 14 years ago. Stratford is behind. You know, if you check out other districts, you know, you can see that Stratford is behind on so many levels. And while we continue to push back and we continue to slow down the pace, our students, because they're the ones in the classroom, they're the ones that are trying to make their careers. You have your career, we are established. These kids need an opportunity to say, you know what, starting in this grade or whatever, I'm gonna be pushed to the highest level I can be so that I can become the next teacher. You know, but some of our students, if we level them, when they get to high school, they have no drive. I talk to parents, I talk to the students, and they feel like, you know what, the teacher doesn't expect anything of me. How do you know that? Because of the classroom that they're placed in high school. The classes that are picked for them sometimes in the high school. So, you know, if we encourage that in the lower levels, then I think we'll begin to see a shift in our students, that their attitude, their mindset will change. We need to have something that tells all of our students, all of the parents, people coming into the district as well, that in Stratford, every student is expected to be a high learner. Every student is going to be taught. And for the teachers, I understand that. You know, as a professional, new things get passed on to us all the time. New software gets introduced. I can't tell my boss, I can't do this. Like, what are we doing? Oh, give me another year to figure this out. No, you know, if something comes to it and it's gonna benefit the company, it's gonna benefit our customers, then you know, we have to step into the plate because ultimately that's the job I chose. I chose to do this job. So I just feel like that as teachers, I think I applaud our teachers. I know they have a hard job. But I feel like a lot of the teachers here would like to see all of their students achieve, and they would like to be given the opportunity. And if it's not this, then it has to be something that pushes all of our students to that next level.
If I may, what happens to the...
Oh, I'm sorry, I apologize.
I'm sorry. Give me a call tomorrow.
I'll get it on Facebook.
tonight, since we to take it 2 hours to discuss this one topic, and I know it's up for action, but I would like to see this committee consider the fact that it was a great presentation. The concept is, I think, well-formed and presented well, and I think a lot of the committee members have made good points in regard to timing. I do like to hear a little more on that teacher survey, what the teachers say. I'd also like to know the specific training that was being done, I mean, to be presented, not just now. But I also think that because of the environment that we are in, we're here to benefit the children, and we have to make sure that what we make a decision on, the parents have been given the information, the data, so they can dissect it and ask questions, just like the young gentleman wanted to do. Because this is a small room. Not everybody could come to this meeting to listen and see the presentation. Yes, I know, Lou, you do a great job getting it out there, as long as I'm not on tape. But I really think the mock classroom, so that parents can see it in action, ask their questions. We no longer are one-size-fit-all. And I think, I kind of like this non-leveling, which incorporates all levels of the children. I like the options that they choose, not our parents and not the administration, that the children can come to their levels in their own way. I just like to take a little more time, not send it to the board this month. Maybe, possibly, if we can get this out to the parents, out to the public, so that I don't want to see a Facebook
you're still going to be Facebook.
I know, but I want them to understand that we want to give them the option. We want them to understand, you have your questions. These two people back here are the experts. They're the ones that have been working on it for the past few years. They're going to answer your questions, and they're going to answer it, I think, very clearly, because I think you were very transparent, and you had fabulous facts that I don't think can be truly disputed. But we are Stratford, and we are who we are. And I would just like to make sure that everybody has an opportunity. Okay? Did I say that?
That's good. Can I just ask about the timing? I'm right. Like David, I'm concerned about.
I would like to see this, might be personally, let me just say, I would like to see this rolled out in September, as going forward, because I have a family business, and I understand you have to, modify, you have to make changes, the times change, the people you hire change, so it's always going to be flexing, so I want the parents to understand that. This is not something that is just going to be static. We roll it out, it's done. No, they're going to constantly work on it. And I think the future Board of Education members will also make sure that they are accountable for going forward. Because I have faith in a lot of the board members that are on the board. So for me, I'd like to hold it for at least one more month, if you can get this out to the parents, David?
I'd like to make a motion, Madam Chair.
Sure.
I'd like to make a motion that we forward this to the board, and that whatever other questions arise can be presented to the board with the activities finished. That's a motion.
That's a motion. I have a second. Jancy? All right, do you want to, all those in favor?
Well, I have to say
any discussion? Oh, I think we discussed.
No, I agree with David.
All right, any further discussion? Yes.
Will those questions be answered that Eric asked prior to the board meeting?
I mean, we can get that information to you. Mr. Darcy and I will work tirelessly to get it all to you before the board meeting on
We have cops set up in our classroom.
No, but I want to make sure because it's Monday.
Monday.
It's on Monday. Yes, we can do that.
Can this PowerPoint go out?
Oh, it's already out.
To the parents. Oh, yeah. It's put on, it's out on social media.
But I mean, to your
parent portal. It's on the district website already.
All right, the parent portal, do they have like copies of it?
It's on the
district.
Not everybody goes to the website.
We could e-blast it out.
We both do a Friday.
If the board in its wisdom isn't satisfied that it's cooked well, then it could be tabled or voted there as far as moving from this committee to the board.
All right, any other discussion? No, so I have a motion, I have a second. All those in favor, it's sending to yes.
So if they forward it up to us, it's their responsibility to get us the information. We don't have to act. If they can't get us the information that we need, it sits and it's on them to bring us the information before it goes forward. I'm just saying, before it's on them to bring it back. And we have the ability to discuss it. If we don't like it, it doesn't go the way that we think it should, then it falls back on them. And it's their job to get it right. Doesn't go out until it's right. I'm saying that it doesn't go out. It will not. I like the honors option. The program is not the way that I think it should go. It's not going to be that coming from the panel there.
My concern, and again, I agree with you. I think it was so well said what you said. I think timing is very important. I don't think it's a reflection on teachers or in terms of them not wanting to make this apply, and that's what my concern is. I'm saying it could work beautifully, but to make it fly, people need time to prepare. I'm still
right. And that's up to the leadership of the two principals are standing in front of us, mm-hmm. telling us that they've talked to their teachers for the last 3 years. And it's incumbent upon them to do their job. Those teachers need to answer honestly and can they be ready to handle this type of program. If the assistant superintendent says it can be ready for September, it's gotta roll out. If it doesn't, I'm not gonna do it positively for it until it's done right.
I just want to give some clarity around our task. So you want
teacher surveys.
Survey Monkey, not anonymous.
Yeah, that's easy.
We can do that, Mr. Darcy.
How do you want?
So I'm assuming how you get the information, as long as you can present
and all the training that you've had for the last 2 years.
And all the training. So
survey on
training for the principals and the teachers, yes. Because we've all been helping.
Right.
Okay.
Where?
Yeah. Your staff needs to work. You mentioned that Dr. Robson under her tutelage has gotten necessary training that you need to fill out a program of this magnitude. We've already done it. It's already been started. But to move it across a district of a couple hundred teachers in middle schools, it's a monumental task.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That is what I need. That's what I'm doing.
Survey and training.
Yes. And any other questions that any other board members, those are just mine.
Mm-hmm.
And quite frankly, just making sure that your teachers are going to be prepared to move a program this size through your two middle schools.
Okay.
And part of that preparation comes with our leadership, right? We are responsible for building the capacity and getting our teachers ready for. That's why we hire. So we are committed to doing that. We will get that information to you before Monday. We appreciate your questions. Anything else that you need from us, from the committee?
She's talking. All right, so that was our discussion.
Okay.
So there's no more discussion. We have a motion on the table. We have a second. Can you repeat the motion, David?
To forward to the board for its action and additional information needed that be presented to the board.
Is it second?
That's my second.
Discussion was had. All those in favor say aye. Or
aye.
Do we have a roll call vote maybe?
Do a roll call.
Okay, Helen?
Aye.
David?
Aye.
Danielle? Aye. Jancy?
Aye.
Susan?
Aye.
Okay.
He's the chair. Oh, I'm sorry, Robin. Robin is right next to me.
And Eric too?
Eric, okay.
Well, he's being Monica.
He's being with your Monica tonight? Okay. Then, okay, so, and as the chair, I say aye. So we will unanimously send it forward to the board with a favorable recommendation. With the
consideration.
With the consideration.
Pending
the teacher survey and the training, the 3-year training. Okay. All right. Thank you very much. That was a very long discussion. Well done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Good job.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now,
just leave aside the other item table. There's no action on it anyway.
No, there isn't. So you don't want to do that at all tonight. Okay, then I need a motion on the table for item 4, ALP program. Then I need a motion for adjournment.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second. Robin, Eric. All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
How are you?